The Healthcare Security Cast is sponsored by 3D Network Technology. Reliability is our core value. Visit www.3dnetworktechnology.com. And by Genetec, delivering security strategies for healthcare. Visit Genetec, that's Genetec.com. And by the Change Execution Group. Visit 360lifetransformations.com.
Welcome to the Healthcare Security Cast, the podcast dedicated to healthcare security, safety, and emergency management. If you are involved with a healthcare security program or desire to be, this podcast is for you. Join the conversation as we discuss the issues that matter to healthcare security professionals while leveraging the expertise of healthcare security thought leaders and experts in personal development. And now, here's your host, Brian Hamilton.
Welcome to the Healthcare Security Cast for Tuesday, January the 26th. I'm joined today by Ted Bowen. Ted, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, how's it going? I appreciate you bringing me on here.
Definitely happy to have you on, Ted. Now, I always like to start off with the first question by getting to know our guest a little bit. So I'll start off by asking, who is Ted Bowen?
All right. Well, I'm definitely passionate about security. I spend a lot of time outside of work with my family, getting my ministry started, Internal Grind Gym Ministries. And those are the three things I spend a lot of my time doing outside of security. So I'm about the ministry, about the family. That's me.
Okay, excellent. And I'm actually curious now, you piqued my interest about the Internal Grind Ministry. What's the ministry all about?
Basically, what I did was I took something I was passionate about, which is weightlifting, exercise. And I thought, you know, there's got to be other people out there with the same passion. So I started my ministry by bringing people into it, working out, exercising, discussing any questions they would have, or we talk about scripture, things like that. We bring the workout into it. So that's been great.
Okay, cool. Now, I want to shift focus a little bit and learn more about what led to you doing the work you do today. So let's talk a little bit about your career. What's led to you actually getting into the healthcare sector and being a leader in this area?
Great, thank you for the question. Yeah, so my background has been in security for about 17 years. It's been very interesting because I've worked in the casino field, corrections, and healthcare. And I found a lot of purpose in the healthcare sector versus the other ones, actually. And I received an opportunity when I was in corrections to build a healthcare security department from the ground up. So they didn't have any policies or procedures. I mean, not even radios, uniforms, they didn't have nothing. And I was blessed with this opportunity. So I jumped in on it. And I believe I got to this point because of I was willing to like show up. I was willing to do the work, the trainings, stay involved in basically anything healthcare as far as researching and diving in.
You touched on one thing there that kind of stuck out to me, and you talked about just being willing to show up and do all of the training. What was some of the training that you took part in that really helped you get to where you are?
We got defensive tactics, use of force trainings. Actually, I took this great training. It's called a psychiatric emergency response training. There's trainings from National Anger Management, I believe is what it's called. And so you learn a lot about anger management there. Just getting involved like with corrections, being in different academies. I was in juvenile academies, adult corrections academies. Just having just a mixture of all that really, really helped. And that's the kind of trainings I try to like when I'm building a program now. In those trainings, I just kind of all took all those and put them into one basket and creating a program myself.
Excellent. Now, as far as your career, I'm sure there's people who have influenced you along the way and really helped you grow in the field. Who are your mentors and what are some of the things that you've learned from them?
Well, to be honest, I believe we all have a few people that help us, right? From the beginning, I don't believe we get anywhere in life without a hand up, meaning advice, mentoring, someone showing us, someone giving us an opportunity, of someone planting a seed in you. But I did have a couple of people that brought me up fast, actually, and actually in the casino field. They also made it hard. They made it hard and fast for me. So meaning they brought me up fast, but they didn't make it easy. Sitting down with the red pins and going over report structure, every scenario I was in to sit down and tell me how I could do it better. they just brought, and then they give me opportunity and they give me the trust to go out and do those things. And every time I come back, it's you could have done this better. And then we come up with a game plan to make it even better the next time. And just doing that for a long period of time under those mentors, it helped out a lot.
Absolutely. I could definitely see how that would be impactful in a positive way. Now, seeing that you'd spent time in the casino and in the corrections field as well, what were some of the skills that you found that transferred well to healthcare? And I guess some of the things as well that you would have had to kind of adapt to in the healthcare environment.
So as far as the casino part of it, I like to use this example, customer service. For instance, like when I open a door now for a patient, I'm opening a door, but I'm also watching and paying attention. Without that person knowing that's coming to the facility, I can ensure they don't have weapons. I can find out what their body language is like. You know, if they just had an argument or something in the parking lot, using those customer service skills and working with the patient, opening the door for them, getting them wheelchairs, escorting them to the car, just noticing things. I mean, they don't even know what's happening, but I'm able to notice these things and giving the customer service at the same time is what I took from the casino world and brought over and mixed it into the healthcare field. With corrections, oh man, de-escalation, finding it just a lot of de-escalation is what I brought over there. And I was able to wrap it up with, you know, working with different types of patients. Cause where I'm at now is a community healthcare center. So we deal with medicated assisted treatment. We deal with behavior health, medical, family medical, dental. I mean, all of it wrapped into one. So it really helps with that de-escalation.
I guess when you look at it, one thing that people say about healthcare a lot is your clientele is primarily going to be people who don't necessarily want to be in the facility. They're there for some kind of negative reason. And I guess really the same thing applies in corrections for the most part as well.
Right, right. They definitely don't want to be there. So I can agree with that. But the thing is, I noticed with healthcare though, is what's a plus side to that, when they come in the doors, you know, they're really trying to get help and they're really trying to seek that care, whether it's a medicaid assisted treatment, whether it's the behavior health, or just getting something checked out for their dental or medical. So the plus side of that is they're going there for help. So that's the difference, I would say.
Excellent. Now, was there anything that kind of surprised you coming into the healthcare field that you had to really adapt to that was different than anything that you've done to this point?
Yeah, I talk about it all the time. Is I'm so used to, like, here's your security structure, here's your use of force, you can do this, you can do that. And then you come into the healthcare field and now we're dealing with management boards, C-suites, everything's a liability. I definitely have to have a lot more patience and understanding that I necessarily didn't have to have in the other, that makes sense.
The one thing too that you mentioned about the program that you're in is, you know, you basically started from scratch. So you really had the opportunity to leave your fingerprints on a new security program. What were some of the important considerations in the process of building a security program in a healthcare environment?
So I would say it really starts with knowing first that you're going in and nobody has a clue. This is new to everyone. And then finding out who your C-suite is, meet them, go up there and talk to them about what you see, what you have observed, talk to staff, talk to your patients, find out what is it that brought the conversation to the table that we need security here now. And then showing up after you learn all that information, you gather all that information. It goes back to showing up, dealing with their patients respectfully and professionally. And I think that helps gain trust. So they're going to start trusting you and your ability of what they've asked you to do. And then as you grow, it's taking what I just did by myself, learning the staff, learning the C-suite, and having the security officers coming on do the same thing at an individual level. And then them showing up, letting them step back, let them show up so they can see the staff and the C-suite and patients can trust these officers as well. And so we don't have security like rushing in with their chest out, you know, or like bulls in a china closet. We just make sure that they're dealing with the training program, they're showing up, and it really helps when the staff can see that, oh, I can respect this guy. This guy's going to handle our patients with respect and kindness, and we feel safe. That doesn't happen overnight, something I learned.
No, I could definitely see that being the case. I'm sure training plays a big part in that, and that's kind of what we'll focus on for a bit here. So obviously training is an important part in a new program or any program really. So being an important part of the equation, how do you prepare and assess security officers in a new environment?
I do want to talk for a second about how it's really hard, I found, to find training geared specifically either towards hospital healthcare security or community healthcare centers. So I decided I got to do something to, again, go back to the last question and build the trust, build the confidence in security. And so what I did is I got this, everybody has that, most places you have 90 days to see if you can perform your duties, and if not, they let you go. But so I decided to take that 90-day and turn it into a field training program. And what it is you have an officer who is a field training officer who works one-on-one with the new hire. And every 30 days, that field training officer will have meetings with that new hire officer, and then bring the file, bring the notes, bring everything to the supervisor. And the field training officer and the supervisor will discuss what's going on, what they think they can do better. And then the supervisor will meet with the new security officer. So what we do in that 90 days is they have to, first and foremost, we have to get them to, you know, meet staff, do their rounds, learn policies and procedures of that facility. They have to pass their international healthcare security certification, their basic. They have to do defensive tactics, de-escalation, crisis intervention, mental health first aid. All these things have to be complete within that 90 days, and they have to be showing progress in anything that need to be corrected, or else they know ahead it's a pass or fail. So if you fail, then we move on. And if you don't, great, you pass it and you go on to better things.
Excellent. Now, to focus a little bit more on the training piece, you talked about, you know, a number of different elements there. When you're assessing somebody over that 90-day period, what are some of the things specifically that you're looking for, and specifically some of the training that your officers are going to be doing?
So some of the things that I'm looking for as a supervisor is, what are they doing when they get into certain situations? Let's say they have a patient who is, you know, just getting upset and pacing up and down. Is that officer staying patient? Are they staying the calmest one in the room? Are they coming up with solutions? Are they listening? I mean, this is, we haven't even completed all the training, but I'm trying to find out how they are as a person. So I'm looking for things. I'm looking for their body language. I'm looking, are they irritated? Are they being patient? I'm observing all those things, and then we'll take notes, and then this is what we need to improve on.
As far as integrating the team into the hospital, again, because it's a new position, what was kind of the approach of really integrating security into the culture? Was there any communication that happened, or I'm just curious what that process was of really introducing a new security program into a healthcare facility?
Right. So at first it was very, I don't want to say tense, but everybody, what are you doing here? Why do you need to be here? This is a clinical setting. What's going on? A lot more from the patients. I had the patients question a lot. What do you need to be here for? What's going on? Is there something happening? That went on for a few months. And with staff, you know, you got kind of the same thing. And then they realized how much easier it is to be able to pull a panic alarm or to make a radio call, and then to focus back on the patient in front of them, why security maybe could de-escalate a patient, you know, down the lobby, down the way a little bit. And I also found that just by listening to that feedback of why we need to be here, and then listening to the feedback of how nice they believe it is now, that they've seen, again, they were able to build trust in what I was doing, what I was saying, how I was treating their patients, and just really observing their reactions, observing the C-suite reactions to me and what I was doing. And then what I had to do was make it part of the culture. I really had to take all that information and bring it to the C-suite, and they bring it to, you know, the board, because really they're really leading the tone. They're really setting the tone, the management is. And so if they see all this work that I'm doing and they're getting the information, and then they can set the tone for the staff, it just became a lot easier that, hey, security is going to be here now. But it does take, you're right, it does take work. It takes time. It takes a lot of conversations. But eventually the staff will hear from management, and they really set the tone for security, and then they get comfortable with it, because they tend to follow what management says, right?
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's awesome. Now, I want to circle back to the training again. I know this is kind of a big topic for me, and I'm just kind of fascinated by, you know, the way you had to start this program, and I really want to look more at some of the some of the skills that you trained on, and specifically, well, I guess I'll start with report writing. When you're training new staff in a healthcare environment, what are some of the things that you focus on with report writing, and what are you really looking for from a competency level?
Basically, what I'm looking for is just the proper structure, really. So the officer's name, the time of the event, who, what, where, when, how, you know, the basic report writing, but making sure that they also have, because it depends on where you work. There's some places that want like patient numbers, patient IDs, just making sure that they can understand the structure, because I think it's very important, because there's been times in healthcare where I've had to submit a report to a police officer or submit a report to a lawyer or things like that. So it's really important to me that the structure gets down solid. So when I hope in that 90 days, my hope is I just started this program and I have one guy pass so far, and I'm finding that his structure is pretty well, pretty good. But my hope is that the structure, it just is solid for those incidents where something has to go to a lawyer or court or anything like that. So I just focus on, it seems basic, but it's really important. It's just the skeleton of it, man. Really.
No, absolutely. I could definitely see that being the case. That obviously reporting is an important piece. And, you know, as much as I think once you get into a certain role in the security field, it's easy to, I guess as leaders, it's really easy to make assumptions about something. So, you know, obviously you'd have a really good understanding of report writing, and there's certain things that you would expect. And I know I was very much the same way. I had a baseline expectation, and, you know, it was, at first it was a challenge for me when people couldn't meet that expectation, but, you know, you realize that you're in the role that you're in for a reason. And maybe, you know, for me anyways, I had to really focus on bringing people up to that level, or, you know, at least, like you said, you want a certain structure that you want to make sure that they have that competency, but you can't really assume that they're going to pick that up on their own.
Right. And again, that's why I decided, just because of experience before, we have to do, I mean, it could be longer than 90 days, maybe 120 or something, but it's like, there has to be a period. I believe that these new security coming into healthcare security need to have a period of time where it's pass or fail. Because I believe in certain things, it's just like the de-escalation and things like that's just too important. You have to learn all those things, and you have to be proficient at it in order to run a safe environment. And report writing is all part of that training, and that, I think it has to go with it. So,
all right. One of the things that I noticed that I really like that you do is you focus on the causes of aggression in your training as well. And then from there, you move on to look at crisis intervention and de-escalation. I'm just curious, when you're actually teaching that content, when you're delivering that education, what are some of the things that you're teaching these new officers to really help them understand the causes of aggression in a healthcare environment?
Well, basically what I do before I start the causes of aggression portion of the training is I ask them to put themselves as much as they can in a spot of a patient in a certain situation. So for example, feeling at the mercy of an uncaring healthcare system, okay? How would you feel in that situation where you feel like maybe the front desk or maybe even your provider, if somebody's not understanding you and you're getting frustrated and they're blowing you off and the only way to get your help is to come to this hospital or this clinic? Or so I just ask them to put themselves in that situation. And the same thing, you know, because I'm just going to run through like basically what I find in the healthcare field are some of the causes of aggression, right? So that feeling at the mercy of the healthcare system, adverse staff interactions, right? So how would you feel if this staff member is blowing you off to try to get to the next person and not really listening to you to hear that maybe, you know, I need to be in this appointment now, I can't wait, and the staff member may be blowing you off. I'm feeling denied. Maybe a staff member said, no, I'm not going to give you this information, or I'm not going to be able to help you with this to get you to your next appointment. How do you feel? How would you feel if you were shut down? So then I start. So I definitely spend a lot of time of trying to get them to be in the position of the patient or the person coming in or the visitor. And then I have them paint a picture of, has there ever been a trauma in your life? Because especially in the healthcare field, that person could be having the worst day of their life when they walk in there. You don't know what news they just got. You don't know if they're there with their parent that's sick and dying. So basically I try to, you know, you have experienced something in your life, I'm sure, that was traumatic. And then you go to try to make a basic appointment maybe, or maybe you just want to go see a dentist and you're already all stressed out. You know, we got to put ourselves in their positions. and really pay attention to those signs, you know, and their body language and things like that. Why maybe they, you know, what's causing this aggression versus, you know, like I said, the whole thing that I see a lot is the whole puffy chested, I got to be the biggest one in the room, security guy that just escalates everything.
You know, I agree with you 100% there. One of the most important things in the healthcare environment as a frontline worker, especially is the empathy piece. And you really kind of nailed that right there with the way you bring that up in the training. So that's, from my perspective, that's awesome that you take that approach.
It still blows my mind some of the lack of training there is really on really just dissecting what de-escalation is and causes of aggression, and even your security officer's mental preparedness. And so as like I said, it just blows my mind. So yeah, I tried to focus on always tried to just break it down and dissect it and make sure they're understanding it in that period that it was allotted for them.
Excellent. And I would also be remiss if I didn't ask you, because you did mention it, about IHSS and the basic training, the CHSO. How have you tied that into your program? And I'm just curious as to your reasoning behind bringing it in and making it part of the program. Well, what was it that really made you see the value in that training?
Right. So actually, when I'd say about 7-8 years ago, when I took the basic, I thought it was great information. It was especially coming in as a new officer. And I also, you know, I also think when an officer has to study or has to read up on something and then gets a certification for it, again, I think it gives purpose. Like, look what I achieved, look what I did. And then and to be honest with you, if I ever wanted the security officers that I get graduate and move on, you know, there's a lot of places that require that certification. So I wouldn't be a good leader if I didn't say, hey, this is going to be good for you in the future if you want to move up or move on. And that's why I decided to get the supervisor one myself, so I can have that as well. Because I think if it's a requirement at most places, then I'd be doing my staff a disservice not to make it part of the program.
Excellent. And it's, you know, that relates to a conversation I had a few days ago as well, kind of around the same thing. One of my good friends who's a security manager is taking kind of the same approach. Now, he didn't roll the training right away because he didn't have the certifications himself. So he was going through and doing that just to set the example for his team.
Yep. That's why I did the supervisor one, because I wanted my team as well to see, and I put mine right next to theirs on the wall in the office. I'm doing it. I expect you guys to do it. You know, let's get it done. So that's how I look at that certification. Like I said, I just think it's going to benefit them.
All right, great. We covered quite a bit here, Ted. Now I'm just curious, obviously, you know, you have this program on the go and it seems like you're working a number of officers through the 90-day training process. I'm just curious, what can we look forward to from you in the future?
Well, I have been working with Security Magazine. I did have a webinar out a few months ago called Healthcare Security and Community Healthcare Centers. And now they allowed me to author an article in their magazine. It's going to be live March 17th on their website, Security Magazine.
Excellent. We'll definitely watch for that. What's the title of the article, just so people can keep an eye out for it?
Yeah, it is healthcare security, but is a specialized field.
All right, excellent. Healthcare security is a specialized field, so watch out for that for sure. As we're coming to the end of our time, is there anything I haven't asked you yet that you'd like to discuss further?
No, not at all. I appreciate your time. The questions you have asked, I think they're great. Thank you.
Hey, you're very welcome, and thank you for coming on. Now, one chance just to share a message with the Healthcare Security Cast community. Is there anything you want to say to everybody listening?
I do, actually. I just want to, first of all, say thank you again for having me on here. And I think healthcare security is a specialized field. And I would like to see more programs, pass or fail, integrated in the industry. And I'm going to ask that people keep showing up, that I appreciate what they do. I care about what they do. I appreciate what they do. I would really like to send a message for everybody to, you know, make sure you're debriefing and talking to your staff and mental health checking your staff, stay in the gym. And I just appreciate all you guys. Thank you.
Awesome. No, it's a very, very important message. Now, for anybody who's listening that wants to reach out to you, what's the best way to connect with you?
Well, that would be LinkedIn. I got my Internal Grind Ministries Facebook page, if that's something that interests anyone. But yeah, LinkedIn is like the best way to contact me right now. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, yeah, if you haven't connected with Ted yet on LinkedIn, Ted Bowen. And Ted, thank you very much for joining. I had a great time talking to you today.
Yeah, man. Thank you. I appreciate you.
And this concludes another episode of the Healthcare Security Cast. Thank you for tuning in. Join the Healthcare Security Cast community. To join, text START to 647-372-2042. Again, that's text START to 647-372-2042. Follow the Healthcare Security Cast on LinkedIn and Facebook, and join the Healthcare Security Cast community groups on both platforms as well. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. And of course, you can always connect with me on social media. I'm the only Brian, B-R-I-N-E, Hamilton, on any of these platforms. For any of these links, visit my website, Brian, B-R-I-N-E, Hamilton.com. That's BrianHamilton.com. Thanks again for joining us. Tune in again next week when we have a new guest and a new topic. Until then, take care and stay safe.